Hello friends, namaste mitro. So today's topic is surface facility. So what do you mean by surface? So in petroleum industry, surface is basically on is defined surface is defined as above the wellhead or after the wellhead. So now what do you mean by surface facility? So surface facility can be defined as a set of equipment and pipes which use to extract, to transport, to process and to export the oil and gas in safely, safe, controlled and efficient manner, which is basically located on the surface. So this is basically definition of surface facility. When we are talking about surface facility, the first question come into our mind is what need of a surface facility? Why we can't transport crude oil directly to the refinery? So this is our refinery. So why we can't transport our crude oil directly to the refinery? So problem is, we, as we all know, that we get four commodities in a as a well fluid, starting with oil, water, gas and solids. So problem with water is water, if we are transporting the mixture of oil and water and there is a presence of any air or gas, it will form a hydrate. Now with gas, problem is if as a well fluid or as a well gas, there is not only natural gas is coming. With natural gas means with methane and ethane, our H2S and CO2 is also coming. So this acidic gases are will develop the corrosion in the pipeline. Now problem with solid is here fluid velocity is very high. So due to this solids, our pipe can be eroded. So these are the basically flow assurance problem. That's why we can't transport oil directly to the refinery. So now there is a need of surface facility. Now it's depend on location that you are talking about offshore or onshore. Both for both surface facility is different. So let me start with the onshore surface facility. So for we need a field separation. So for that there is a GGS. GGS means group gathering station, where basically two-phase separation is done. Means your gas and liquid. Now your maybe at GGS you have facility of three-phase separation, so you have to transport your oil to the CPF or CTF. It's depend on location. Like CTF is used when there is only need of separation of water, gas and oil. So CTF is basically central tank farm. CPF is central processing facility, which is used to extract the naphtha and your LPG at the field only. So your VAP means your naphtha and any or products will directly go for the sale, and oil will go to the refinery. Now any refinery has a minimum water and basic sediment water and basic sediments percentage, so that should be fulfilled by CPF or CTF. Now from GGS your gas will come to gas processing, your gas compressor facility. Now it's called as a GCP. From GCP your gas can be go to the injection or go to the lift. So there may be a gas lift or there may be a swag or wag or gas injection for the pressure maintenance. Your gas can be go to any facility, and your gas will directly, a high pressure gas will directly go to the consumer also. Now water will directly pump from GGS to the ETP. Now ETP is effluent treatment plant. So from the effluent treatment plant, water will go directly go to the pure water will directly go to the injection. So there are the percentage that should be satisfied by your water that you are injecting, and treated effluent will directly go for the disposal. So this is basically normal surface facility for the onshore. Let me give an overview of GGS. GGS means group gathering station. So starting with the three headers, first one is HP header, second one is general header or low pressure header, and third one is test header. So normally your wells are diverted in HP header and your low pressure header. So for each means HP and LP, there is a two train. It's depend on location or requirement. There may be a single train also, there may be a stage separation also. I will discuss all the things. Now starting with the bath heater, so for both train LP and HP you have a different bath heater is there. So bath heater is basically first bathyder is at the first because it will reduce the viscosity by increasing the temperature. So if you are having heavy oil or high viscous oil, for good separation, you can reduce the viscosity by use of bath heater. Now, second one is your separator. So for each train, HP train, you have HP separator, and for LP train, you have LP separator. Now, here three-phase separation or two-phase separation may be done. Basically, mostly three-phase separation is done. So here, gas will directly go to the consumer, or you can flare. So generally, HP gas is directly go to the consumer after your KOD and scrubber. So KOD and scrubber are there to dehydrate the gas and basically to reduce the, to increase the liquid recovery. And now your high pressure gas can be directly go to the consumer, or you can use the compressor also. So for low pressure gas, you have suction KOD, which is also has same function as gas scrubber, that you dehydrating the gas. And you can compress it, and you can sell it to the consumer, or you can flare the LP gas. Flaring facility is also present in GS. Now coming to the oil part, oil. If you have three phase separation, then your oil will directly go to the heater treater, and your water will directly go to the directly dispatched to the effluent treatment plant. You can have a pump for dispatching the water. Your oil will directly go to the heater treater. So generally there is a single heater treater. So you mix your LP and HP well. Means your oil will directly come to the heater treater. And heater treater is basically increasing the temperature to reduce the emulsion, and it's also to separate it's also used to separate good separation efficiency by increasing the temperature or breaking the emulsion. So here may be electrical or non-electrical heater treater you can use. Now from heater treater you can break your emulsion, and from that your water will directly go to the ETP, and your oil will directly go to the oil storage tank. So there is a storage tank which present in GGS. Generally in ONGC, in GGS you can find 200 meter cube or 300 or 500 meter cube tank on the GGS. It's for temporary storage only. Like if you have let me discuss about your oil dispatch pumps. So there is oil dispatch pump which is continuously dispatching the oil to the consumer, or your CTP, CTF or CPF, central tank farm or central processing facility. So over here, if you have malfunctioning of this dispatch pump, then you require a temporary storage. So for that, your oil facilities, your oil storage tank is there, which can facilitate by storing the oil for temporary basis, like for 1 or 2 days. Now coming to the test separator part. Now you have a separate header for testing, test header. Now you can divert your well, any single well, into the test header. So there is a test separator. Here you can here your gas, you can have a meter for gas metering also, and you can have a meter for your liquid also, or you can have a multi-phase flow meter which will directly give you a water cut and GOR, your producing GOR. Or you can take sample from here, like from the test header, or in downstream of test header, and you can give the sample to the chemist, and chemist will give you a water cut. So this is the basically testing facility. And you have also vertical storage tank for testing where you can basically store your tested fluid. So you can have meter here also, and you can have a meter here also. So these are the general overview of GGS. Now GCP, your high pressure gas or low pressure gas after a medium pressure compressor, your MP gas can be directly float, can be diverted to the GCP. If you required any gas lift gas or gas injection gas, so here there is a stage compression is there. Basically, generally reciprocating compressor are only present. So let's start with the LP gas. So LP gas will directly go to the KOD. Here primary dehydration is done and your gas will directly transfer to the compressor. So this is the first stage of compression. So it's like from 10 to 15 kg it will compress up to 25 or 30 kg. Then you have another KOD to dehydrate the gas. Basically this KOD are present to basically dehydrate the gas. If we are injecting hydrated gas into the well, then it can cause the malfunctioning of your gas lift valve or can be damage your tubings or flow lines. So this KOD are for the dehydration. So here your 30 to 60 or 75 kg your second stage compression is done. And third stage, here medium pressure gas can be directly go to the third stage. And third stage from 60 kg to 90 or 120 kg which is required in your field, you can compress. And at the end also there is a KOD and your HP gas will directly go to the consumers or your gas lift gas or go to the injection facility, gas lift injection for particular wells. And yeah, so this is basically overview of group compression plant or gas compression plant. This is the basically schematic of offshore production system, means your surface facility. So at offshore, basically your all the surface facilities located at process platforms, and there are the wellhead platforms basically which consist of from minimum one well to maximum up to 30 wells, and these all wells are diverted into the group header, which is basically at wellhead platform. So wellhead platform having a basically two header, one is group header and second one is test header. Test header is for testing facility and group header is basically connected with the riser, means your underground subsea pipeline which connects your process platform. So your well fluid is directly going to the process platform. Yeah, and if your well are gas lift well, then there is another riser which is coming from the process platform to the unmanned platform, means your wellhead platform, which basically your gas lift your lift gas is coming from the process platform. And yeah, another, if you are having a water injection for pressure maintenance wells, if you are having a water injection wells at your unmanned platform or your wellhead platform, then you are also having a water subsea line, means your water riser coming to the unmanned platform. And there is a header, gas header also there, and water header is also there. From water header, your flow line is connected to the well, where your injection line is connected to the well, and gas lift injection lines are also there for the different wells. Now this is the basically all surface facility, means your starting from your bath heater to your separator, then your heater treater, then your pumps, all are located on process platform only. Process there may be a different process platform for gas, means like for gas processing there may be a different process platform, or for oil there may be a different platform, but all the process means all the surface facility are on the process platform only. And there is a living quarter connected with the process platform. Now here we are pumping the oil. After the separation, we are pumping the oil to the onshore terminal. For Western Offshore Unit, it's basically Uran. We are pumping oil to the Uran. And from Uran, after storage and another separation, or maybe your removal of a condensate and naphtha, the oil is directly sent to the refinery. Now these are the basically components of offshore production system in your offshore surface facility, starting from wells may be subsea wells or platform wells, wellhead platforms means your unmanned platforms or your servicing rigs, then the feeder pipelines means your underground pipelines or risers, which are basically connecting your wellhead platform to your processing platform, then the export pipeline for oil and gas. Means maybe you are having mud, for Western Offshore you have mud and bird, Mumbai to Uran pipeline and Bombay to Uran pipeline are there, which is basically exporting your oil to the Uran facility. And same you have for gas, you have Hazira. So Mumbai to Hazira pipeline is also there to basically export the gas to the Hazira facility. Now, if you don't have your subsea pipeline to the onshore terminal, then you may have a like mooring, like single bay mooring system, which basically tank which basically can be connected with the tanker to basically evacuation of oil. So this is basically unmanned platform or valet platform, and this is the basically process platform here. This is basically Amazon process platform. These are the living quarters. This is your MNP, Mumbai High process platform, and and this is also unmanned platform which is connected with the process platform. This is for water injection, MNW. Let's start with the surface Christmas tree. So in oil and gas industry, a Christmas tree is referred as a series of valve and spool assembly which is fitted on the valve. Means your well head, so it's fitted on your production casing. So there is a tubing hanger, on that there is a tubing head adapter. So functions of Christmas tree is here. So first is it's allow the reservoir fluid to flow from the well to the surface facility in a controlled manner. Second one is it allow a safe access to the well bore in order to perform any well intervention program. Third one is allow injection and production of your gas or water. Fourth one is it provide the access to the hydraulic line for the surface, means your subsurface safety control valve, SSSV. So these are the four functions, and fifth one is especially for the ESP, that it's allow the power cable for the ESP. So these are the function of your Christmas tree. Now let's start with the master valve. So these two are the master valve. So master valve is located above the tubing hanger, and its function is to allow the fluid to shut or to flow in the well. Typically there are the two master valve, one which is at lower position, it's called as a lower master valve, and upper one is called as a upper master valve. Generally we operate the upper master valve only, because these two master valves is because of to provide a basically redundancy. Generally we operate upper master valve only. So if our upper master valve get malfunction, then we can isolate well from the lower master valve and we can replace this upper master valve. So these are the basically for the upper master valve. Now our Christmas tree consists of two wing valve. One is production wing valve and second one is king wing valve. So production wing valve is basically to produce from the well in a safely manner, and there is a choke, means your bean housing is connected with the production wing valve, in which you can have your bean. So this whole thing is your bean housing, which is connected with the production wing valve. And king wing valve is basically used when you want to kill the well. So whenever your workover rig will come, it first of all kill the well from the kill wing valve. Now fifth valve, you have a swab valve or crown valve, which is basically used to control and isolate the basically. So top one is basically swab valve or your crown valve. So it is basically providing a vertical access to the well for any well intervention program like wire line, slick line, coil tubing or snubbing unit. So basically provide a vertical access to the well intervention or your workover operations. When basically we visit the well site, we basically have to data collect. So at well site we have to collect THP means tubing head pressure, which is basically we can measure on the T cap is basically above the crown valve. So this is your crown valve or swab valve. So above it there is a T cap. So by needle valve you can take your THP. Then ABP is basically after bean pressure. So below the bean housing, you can connect the gauge, or you can have a needle tapping where you can have your needle valve, and from that you can measure your after bean pressure. Then your CHP or GIP. So at section A,
you can measure your GIP or CHP, GI line flow. So GI line is connected with basically A section, means your annulus between your tubing and your production casing. So from that you can have your turbine meter or your any mass flow meter or any meter. From that you can measure the gas flow, and or you can have your venture meter also. For gas we generally use the venture meter, not turbine meter. For oil metering we can use the turbine meter. So here you can measure the liquid flow by using of turbine meter, and for the gas you can use your venturi or venturi type of flow meter, and you can collect from the flow line sample. So you can collect sample from the flow line. Now bin size, so you already have placed a fixed bin size, so you have to take the size of bin. Then I already talk about liquid flow rate and gas flow rate and water cut. So by taking the sample you can have a water cut by a chemist. Okay, so how to assure the quality of oil and gas into the consumer? So again, for the onshore we have GGS, which is basically primary service facility at the field only. So let's understand the function of each part of the GGS. So collection of well fluid, which is basically done by the group header. Second one is preventing the congealing. So congealing is basically prevented by your bath heater. So this is your header. So this is basically your group header. This is your bath heater. Now separation of gas and liquid. So it's done by the separator, your two-phase separation. Now your separation of oil and water. So liquid will directly go to the wash tank. So wash tank has a function or has to separate oil and water. Now your water is directly go to the ATP, and your oil can be directly go to the storage tank. So storage tank is a function of storage of oil or liquid. So you may have your two-phase separation at a separator or three-phase separation. It depend on requirement on your GGS. Now you have a function of pumping, which is done by basically your main oil line pump MOL, which pump the fluid to the consumer directly or to the CTF or your CPF. Now these are the basically rating for the header. So for on the pressure, your pipe schedule will be decided and your fitting class will be decided. So pipe schedule is from 40 to XXS. So up to 100 kg you can have your 80 class 80 schedule pipe, and above 100 kg pressure you can have 120 or 160. And if you are having high pressure gas wells, then you have to use XS pipe schedule. Same for the fitting. This class is for the fitting only. So you have basically two type of fitting, your butt welded fitting or your forged fitting. So in butt welded fitting you have elbow, tees and reducer, which are already welded on the pipe. So to basically what should be taken as a elbow or tees or reducer, you have to take the class of fitting depend on the pressure for you are basically fabricating your flow line or your gas line. And for the force fitting there are the flange. So flange also having a class up to 150 to 1500 class. So it's basically decide 900 class is also there, is not mentioned here. So it's depend on what is your working pressure requirement. Now starting with the indirect bath heater. So a process bath heater allows a user to indirectly heat the process liquid and gases by the submerging a process coil into the heated bath solution. So here heated bath solution is maybe mostly your oil or water. The bath solution is basically heated by the your fire tube and fire tube style burner. So fire tube is basically having an input of natural gas, means your gas only, which is basically coming from your separator, and air is sucked by the chimney, and you have a burner here which basically burn the fuel, and it will cause a fire in a fire tube, and due to that your submerged produced fluid will be heated. So this is the basically function of your indirect water bath heater. Indirect in term of, we are not direct heating the our well fluid, we are submerging it. So it's same also, it also have a function of like function like your heat exchanger. So typical bath heater consists of insulated shell, removable process coil, removable fire tube, and your stack of burners. Now heating fluid, maybe you can use a water or a mixture of water, glycol, or salt melts. So it's depend on condition and like up to which what temperature you have to heat the well fluid. Separator. So how do you define separator? So separator is basically pressure vessel which works on a principle of pressure reduction to separate the liquid and gas. So how pressure reduction causes the separation of liquid and gas, I will discuss. Now gas is removed by allowing a liquid to stand up for a period of time. So there is a settling time for which liquid is standby in the separator. So gas is removed. Entering liquid from gas can be removed by gravity settling or impingement effect. Okay. Major components are following. So primary settling section means your inlet diverter is there. Then liquid settling section, which is also known as liquid retention section. Gravity settling section, mist extraction, which is basically worked on the impingement. Same baffles, vortex breakers, foam breakers. Factor affecting the design parameter of separator. So characteristic of flow stream will greatly affect the design and operation of your separator. But these are the main the parameters which basically affect the separator, and separation is depend on these parameters. So first one is gas and liquid flow rate. So you are producing GOR and liquid flow rate, operating and design pressure and temperature, surging and slugging tendency of your well or your fluid streams, physical properties of the fluid like density and compressibility. Fifth one is design degree of separation. Sixth one is presence of impurities like sands, paraffin, and scale, forming tendency of crude oil, and last one is corrosive tendency of the liquid. So these are the parameters which affect at the time of designing of separator. Now, normally to increase the liquid recovery, I will you already taught of two type of liberation. One is flash liberation and second one is differential liberation. So in flash liberation, liquid recovery is less. In differential liberation, liquid recovery is maximum. So ideally separation stage should be infinite to increase the liquid recovery, but infinite separation stage is not possible here. So here basically we divide into two stage or three stage or four stage separation. So for generally for first stage, your pressure ratings are normally from 100 to 40 kg, 160 or 40 kg. For the second stage, your pressure rating is operating pressure is 16 kg, and for third stage, your operating pressure is 6 kg, and fourth one is atmospheric, which means your stock tank pressure condition. So these are the basically stage wise separation is there. Now let's understand why separator pressure should be greater than your dew point. So dew point of natural gas reference of pressure or temperature at which your gas will start the condensation. So there is a better value of gas or better quality of gas if hydrocarbon dew point is controlled. So gas when controlled with your hydrocarbon dew point not produce liquid in pipeline. So you all know that at the time of separation, your gas pressure means your at separation pressure is very low, like 6 kg or 8 kg or 10 kg. After that we have to compress the gas. So at that time due to increase in pressure, if separation is done below the dew point, and there is a tendency that liquid will produce in pipeline at the time of transportation. So to avoid that, our separation pressure should be greater than dew point pressure. And same, if liquid will generate, it will basically corrode the pipeline. So thumb rule is generally THP by your THP should be double to the dew point. So like if dew point pressure is 8 kg, then your THP means your tubing head pressure should be 16 kg. So this A point is basically your THP, your B point is your separator condition and D point is your dew point. So your separator pressure should be greater than your dew point. Now type of separator based on number of stages. So I already discussed that maximum recovery in liberation, maximum recovery is achieved in differential liberation. So the recovery can be improved by increasing the stages. Ideally, separation should be done in the infinite stages to basically get the differential liberation, which would basically maximize the liquid recovery. So maximum recovery will get in differential liberation. But here it is not possible because we have to keep the infinite stages. But here in the field, it's not possible. So, but only 2, 3, or 4 stages are possible. So it's the basically number of flash liberations. Now, two-stage separation is basically done for low GOR or low API well fluids. Three-stage separation is in intermediate to high GOR wells. And four-stage separation is basically with high GOR and with high API. Because if API is high, then emulsion tendency is also high. So for that, four-stage separation is required. Now, type of separator based on phases. So there may be a two-phase separation or there may be a three-phase separation. In two-phase separation, there is inlet diverter is there, then gravity settling section is there. So here your liquid collection section is there and mist extraction is there. Here, so there is a no oil and water separation is there, only two-phase separation, means your liquid and gas separation is there. Here in three-phase separation, inlet diverter is present. Over here, liquid settling section is there, then oil bucket additionally is there in three-phase separation, which is basically level, which is basically operated by the level control valve. So there is a water outlet is there, and there is a oil outlet is also there. So water level is maintained by liquid level controller. So your oil will flow above the this oil bucket, and it will directly go into the oil bucket, and by the liquid level controller only it will get signal, and the valve will basically flow the oil out of the separator. And mist accessory is also there, same as two phase separator. And here also the pressure control valve is there. I will discuss how this level control valve and pressure control valve will work. Now type of separator based on the configuration. So there is a vertical separator is there, horizontal separator is there, and spherical test separator is there. Depend on the location where we have to use the separator, we can select the configuration of the separator. So here let's understand how these all three separators are two-phase separator. So let's understand how the flow will occur. So here there is an inlet diverter. So inlet diverter will basically cause the settling of your liquid into the liquid collection section. So this is your liquid collection center section where your liquid will collect, and this is basically your gravity settling section where your liquid will your gas and liquid will separate by the principle of gravity. And at the gas outlet there is a mist extractor is there, which basically cause the impingement effect, and due to impingement effect your liquid droplets will settle down. And there is a pressure control valve which basically control the gas outlet, and there is a level control valve which basically control the liquid level. And this basically there is a LIC is there, liquid indicator and controller, which basically maintain the control by giving a signal to the liquid control valve. So this is about the vertical separator. So for let's come to the horizontal separator. So in horizontal separator there is inlet diverter is also there. Now by the reduction of momentum, your liquid will directly separate it to the gas, because change in momentum will cause to fall the liquid droplets into down into the liquid collection section, and gas will flow in upward direction. So gravity settling section is also there for primary separation by the gravity. Mist extractor is there also there, which use the same as impingement effect, and same your lever control valve and pressure control valve is there. Now coming to the spherical separator. Your flow will start from the topmost part of your spherical separator. So this half spherical structure will basically act as your inlet diverter, which basically reduce the momentum of fluid flow. So this work as an inlet diverter. Then your liquid droplets will settle in the liquid collection center, and this area will work as a your gravity settling section. And here there are the same mist extractor is there, which use the impingement effect. So gas flow will occur like this. Gas will flow from the mist extractor to the topmost part, and here due to impingement effect your liquid droplets will drop into the liquid collection center, and gas has a tube from mist extractor section, so gas will flow in downward section and gas outlet is present here. Same here, liquid level is maintained by the level control valve and pressure control valve, which is basically operated by the multi-troll or your level troll. I will discuss how it works. Now, vertical separators are traditionally older, and it was using usually in skid mounted. So in rig side also you also saw the vertical separator. So basic criteria for use of vertical separator: low to medium GOR, large liquid slug expected, sand paraffin or wax expected, space limitation. So if you have a space limitation, then you can use a vertical separator. Now advantages: so good bottom drain and clean out facilities, less tendency to re-entrainment of your liquid. Full diameter is used for the gas flow to the top. Disadvantage: required a large diameter for a given capacity, okay, more expensive. And last one is difficult to maintain the PSV mounted on the top. So PSV is mounted at the top side, so it's difficult to maintain or difficult to positioning of PSV at the top. Now horizontal separator. So basic criteria is good for medium to high GOR, large volume of gas or liquid is expected. For foamy routes it's best, and generally horizontal separator is used as a three-phase separator. Now required a smaller diameter for a given gas capacity, so its diameter is smaller for the given gas capacity than your vertical separator. Less expensive, sufficient time available for water separation. So here your retention time is higher than your vertical separator. Only shell tap is available for the gas passage, occupies more area. So here this shell area is only available for the gas flow. Compared to the vertical separator, your gravity settling section is very high. Liquid level control is more critical here. Liquid level controller is more critical than your vertical separator. Now these are the basically comparison of vertical separator to horizontal separator. So let's have a look on it. So already advantage discussed, let's discuss again. So good for low to intermediate GOR, it's good for high GOR. Now save the spaces. Vertical separator has required less space, reduce the turbulence and foaming tendency. So for foamy crude, horizontal separator is best. Now provide a better surge capacity. Vertical separator will provide a better surge capacity. Liquid level is not critical here, and cheaper than vertical, so it's cheaper than vertical. And also spherical separator is cheaper than horizontal also, so very inexpensive type of separator. Good for low to intermediate GOR, very compact and easy to shift, and easy to clean. Also vertical separator is also easy to clean. Now good solid handling capacity and good motion handling capacity means here your vortex forming and all will not create that much problem, but here water sprinkler should be there. Required less piping and easier. I already discussed compared to vertical. Here required low piping fabrication and easy to shift and assemble it. Now servo separator can be stacked by for minimizing the space requirement. So in offshore basically there is a need of three phase separator, and as a three phase separator, horizontal separator is best. So basically stack mounted also there in offshore. Now disadvantage, so more expensive, yeah, difficult to transport. Okay, third one is it take longer diameter for the given gas capacity. Now greater space requirement, disadvantage of horizontal separator, liquid level control is critical, surge space is limited. So this liquid level control is depend on your type of your crude. Like if your crude is very heavy and like you don't have a bath heater, then liquid level will really very critical. Operation of LCV and PCV will not operate as ideally set point. Difficult to clean, yeah, horizontal separator is more difficult to clean. Now disadvantage of spherical separator, so very limited liquid settling section is there, difficult to three phase separation. So basically this is your spherical separator is not used for three phase separation, is generally used for second two phase separation, same as vertical separator separation. Now liquid level is critical, surge space is also limited in spherical separator. So what is ideally used for low to intermediate GOR, we can it can handle a large log of liquid, and horizontal separator is used for basically high GOR wells and foaming crudes, better liquid to liquid separation. So here your liquid to liquids means your three phase separation is very good in horizontal separator, low to intermediate, and only for two phase. So there is not basically constant for vertical separator for two phase, but three phase separation is better done in horizontal separator. Now this is the basically schematic and major components of your separator. So let's start with the inlet diverter. So inlet diverter, at inlet diverter, momentum of inlet stream is reduced by change in direction and velocity will help help of half sphere or waffle plates to basically separate the liquid from the gas. So this is basically your inlet breaker or inlet diverter. Here momentum and direction of fluid flow will change. So due to that there is a separation of gases and your liquid. Then your deforming plates. So deforming plates are basically internally inclined parallel baffles which are used to dissipate the foam and reduce the turbulence and collisions of liquid droplets. So basically basically reduce the turbulence and foaming tendency, there are the baffles are there. So these are the basically collision plates, means your baffles, there are basically inclined in shape. In 3D you can see that these baffles are little bit inclined and will basically cause the collision of liquid droplets in gas stream, and which basically uses as a liquid droplets will settle in the liquid collection section. Now mist extractor, so it consists of series of vanes and woolen wires or meshes type used in entrapped liquid droplets. Basically impingement effect will happen at mist extractor. Your gas droplets will collide with each other, and due to that liquid carrying droplets will make a big droplet, and big droplet will settle due to the gravity into the your liquid collection center. Now vortex breaker, so vortex breaker is basically present near the liquid outlet. So basically where the vortex form, it forms where your liquid outlet means your oil outlet or water outlet. So your vortex breaker is present over here. So this is basically vortex breaker, this is also your vortex breaker. So these are the basically major components of it. Now let's understand the primary components of the separator. So starting with the primary settling section or inlet diverter. So when inlet stream enters into the separator, it having a high velocity and turbulent mixture of liquid and gas,
and inlet diverter help to initial gross separation occur by changing the momentum of inlet stream. So instantaneous change in momentum will cause the abrupt separation of your liquid and gas. Change in momentum will cause abrupt change in direction also, and abrupt change in velocity. It causes a separation, initial gross separation of your liquid and gas. So this was the primary separation, primary settling section or inlet diverter. Now liquid settling section. So it is located at the bottom of the vessel and it is the largest part of your separator. It provides the retention time necessary to separate gas from the liquid. To assure that liquid and gas reach equilibrium at separator, a certain liquid storage is required, and this defined as a retention time or average time, which a molecule of liquid is retained in the vessel. So this is the basically definition of your retention time. Now formula of retention time is retention time is equal to liquid volume inside the vessel upon liquid flow rate. Now the degree of separation is basically depends on retention time only, and this retention time is depends on first one is amount of liquid separator can hold, second one is the rate in which liquid enters in your vessel, so your inlet rate, third one is API gravity of your fluid, and fourth one is temperature. So liquid separation will require a large retention time, so that's why in your two phase separator your retention time is less. So this table is for like two phase separation. This is for two phase separation and this is for three phase separation. So for two phase separation above 35, retention time is very less, your 1 minute only, as your API gravity decreases, means your fluid become a thicker or heavier, your retention time will increase. Same for three phase separation minimum retention time is 3 to 5 minutes. And for two-phase separation, it's 1 minute, and maximum time is 20 to 30 minutes. And also, it depends on temperature also. So if your temperature is above 100 Fahrenheit, then 5 to 10 minutes, 80, then your 10 to 20 minutes. And if 60 degree Fahrenheit, then 20 to 30 minutes. So these are the basically, this is all for your liquid settling section. Now coming to gravity settling section. So the gas enters the gravity settling section, its velocity drops. So in vertical separator also and horizontal separators also, the space above the liquid settling section is known as a gravity settling section. So when gas enters into the gravity settling section, its velocity drops, and small droplets that were entrained in the gas will be separated. So due to reduction in velocity, same separation will occur. Now collision plates are used in aid to liquid separation from the gas. So collision plates are also there to basically cause the collision of your liquid droplets, and as your liquid droplets become heavier, they will drop. Now minimum size of 100 to 140 micrometer can be separated by the gravity settling section. Fourth one and most important part of the separator is mist extractor. So the collision section that provides the large surface area to collide and remove the all small droplets. So in gravity settling section also we can find the collision plates, but here the plates are very fine. So basically three types of mist extractor are there, which work basically on the impingement effect. First one is wire mesh, second one is vent type, and fiber based. So this type of mist extractor or your collision plates are very thin or very finer. So basically gas flows through these collision plates will cause the collisions, and liquid having a greater mass means if your liquid droplet will collide, it become a bigger molecule, bigger droplet, and it mass increase. So as mass increase in mass will imping and collision element and fall into the liquid collection center. So as collision increases or impingement effect, by the impingement effect collision will increase, the liquid droplet will make a bigger or heavier droplet, so it causes a fall down of liquid droplet in the liquid collection center. Now minimum 2 to 10 micrometer size droplet can be removed by mist extractor. Above below this size means smaller particle, smaller liquid particle than this size can't be separated by the separator. For that, we require a dehydration unit. Potential operating problem in the separator. So if we are design normal separator, then formic crude is maybe a problem. Paraffin may be a problem. Third one is sand, and fourth one is liquid carrier and gas blowing. So if you already introduce deforming plates or buffets, then this problem can be resolved. This paraffin problem can be resolved by increasing the temperature by using your bath heater. This sand problem is basically depends on which type of separator you have taken. You have vertical separator or horizontal separator. So I will discuss about it. Now liquid carryover means if your separation capacity of separator is not good and your gas log is very high, then liquid will be carry over to the mist extractor, and mist extractor can't also not able to drop the liquid droplets to the liquid collection section. So at that time your liquid recovery will be less, means you are getting less liquid. And gas blowing means when your turbulence is very high in the separator and your separator is not able to separate the gas and liquid stream. At that time your gas will also come at the liquid outlet. So these problems occur when we are not properly designed the separator. Now this is the basically number wise rating to the vertical, horizontal and spherical separator. So let's understand first of all usage. So this is usage. Vertical separator is basically used for low to medium GOR. Horizontal separator is basically used for high GOR, and for small leaks operating at moderate pressure. So when your liquid flow rate is less and pressure is also less, moderate, at that time you can use for separator. These are the basically diagrams. Now liquid capacity or efficiency. So large fluid capacity is for your vertical separator. So I already discussed that liquid capacity is large, but GOR should be low to medium. Now large gas capacity can be handled by the horizontal separator, so it can use for high GOR wells. Capacity rated less, so low efficiency is there. So your liquid flow rate should be also less to medium, and GOR should be in ranging from low to medium range. Now handling the foreign material means your sands or paraffin. So number one is your vertical separator, second number is spherical separator, and third one is your horizontal separator. Separation efficiency. So yeah, horizontal separator rated first because it can also separate the high GOR wells. So yeah, good one. First one is horizontal, second one is vertical, and third one is your spherical. Now ranking is used in Middle East. So these are the basically which type of separator is used in Middle East. So same as your separation efficiency. First one is your horizontal, second one is vertical, and third one is spherical. Now handling foaming oil, or which separator having a good foaming can use in high deforming tendency. So first one is horizontal. So I already discussed buffets or deforming plates can be used in horizontal one. So horizontal one is the best for the foaming tendency crudes. Second one is vertical, and third one is spherical because of its compact size. Spherical come at the last position. Now for maintenance, where vertical separator is very hard, I already discussed for fabrication and maintenance. Now horizontal separator is extremely very good or very cheaper in maintenance, and your spherical is moderate to average. Now cost per unit capacity of installation. So as already discussed, for fabrication and all, your horizontal separator is cheapest. Then your vertical separator, and last one, most expensive one, is your spherical separator. Now this is about the pressure rating of your separator, or your operating, how to design the operating pressure of your separator. So I already discussed your operator pressure should be greater than the dew point, but how much greater than your dew point? So let's understand, because of multi-component nature of your produced fluid, the higher the pressure at which initial separation occur, the more the liquid will be obtained in the separator. So yeah, in a separator point of view, liquid recovery is higher with the higher pressure. So this is the graph of your separator liquid recovery. So this is your liquid volume which you get in separator, liquid volume, and this is the pressure of your separator. So as the pressure increases, your liquid recovery will be increased, but this liquid contains some lighter particles which will condense or will be at higher pressure converted into the liquid. And when your liquid will go to the stoke tank, at that time they will evaporate and it will cause the afterall loss of your liquid. So if pressure for initial separation is too high, and so separator pressure is very high, then too many lighter components will stay in the liquid phase in the separator and can be lost at gas phase at the tank. If your pressure is too low, तो पहले तो हमने डिस्कस कर लिया कि अगर बहुत ज्यादा प्रेशर होगा तो क्या होगा, और अगर प्रेशर बहुत ज्यादा कम है तो नॉट मेनी ऑफ दिस लाइटर कंपोनेंट्स विल बी स्टेबलाइज इनटू द लिक्विड एट द सेपरेटर एंड देयर विल बी लॉस ऑफ गैस फेज. सो इफ योर प्रेशर इज वेरी लेस देन आपको सेपरेटर में ही लिक्विड नहीं मिलेगा उतना ज्यादा, तो दैट्स व्हाई मॉडरेट जो आपके मॉडरेट कंपोनेंट्स होंगे लाइक लाइटर तो आपके हो गए C1 C2 C3 C4 उसके बाद C4 टू C5 और C6 आपके मॉडरेट हो गए. तो यू आर नॉट गेटिंग दिस पार्टिकल्स इन सेपरेटर ओनली, तो दैट्स व्हाई ओवरऑल देयर विल बी अ लॉस इन योर स्टॉक टैंक. सो दिस इज द ग्राफ बेसिकली फॉर द लिक्विड, दिस इज लिक्विड वॉल्यूम इन सेपरेटर, ओके, एंड दिस इज बेसिकली लिक्विड वॉल्यूम इन स्टॉक टैंक एंड योर एक्स एक्सिस इज सेम. ठीक है, so your x-axis is same, your separator pressure SP, so there will be a optimum separator pressure at which you are getting the maximum liquid recovery. So that will be your operating pressure for the particular stage. So here all here the word uses initial separation, so that's why the stage separation idea was introduced. Now ये सब theory तो already I have discussed. So now let's understand how we can divide the stages. So this is the basically formula for the dividing the stages. So R are the ratio per stage, and PD is your discharge pressure, and PS is your suction pressure, and N which you have to calculate is number of stages. Okay. So if there are the four stages or three stages is available or at your surface facility, then your ratio will be less, and if there are less stages available then your ratio will be more. Now coming to the separation design or separation design calculation, basically there are two books in which it is described. First one is Sanjay Gupta. So in Sanjay Gupta is basically natural gas engineering Sanjay Gupta book. So in that there are some parameters are given and some constraints are there, and for can enroll there are the different methods. So let's start with the, you can design by both method. So let's start with the Sanjay Gupta one. So for Sanjay Gupta one, gas capacity. The gas capacity of oil and gas separator has been calculated from many years by the equation of Solder-Brown. So this is a Solder-Brown, very important equation. This can be asked as a theoretical question, like describe the Solder-Brown equation in gate. So V is equal to K under root Lg by rho L minus rho G upon rho G, where basically Q is equal to AV, flow rate is equal to area into velocity, and Q can be described as this. Here there is a factor K. So in Sanjay Gupta, we are considering the factor of K, where in can enrolled, we are considering that our separator is half filled with the liquid. So gas capacity, area should be 1 by 2. Here we doesn't take any half for the area, but we take a K. So what is K? K is the empirical factor. Now it's already described, you have to remember if you are going to calculate the separator design by the Sanjay Gupta one. So for vertical separator, your K range is 0.6 to 0.35, and ideally for without mist extractor for vertical it's 0.117, with extractor in vertical. So if doesn't given any idea of mist extractor or any data of mist extractor, then you have to consider the general. So general one is with the mist extractor. So this is the general one, K factor. means your empirical factor for the calculating the gas capacity for horizontal with mist extractor, it's 0.382, and for spherical it is 0.35. Now gas capacity already discussed. If you are converting it into the field unit, means mmscf per day, then you will get this equation. So very important equation you have to remember if you are going to calculate by the Sanjay Gupta method. Now here we not consider the ideal gas, so P by ZT will come into the picture, where T should be in the Fahrenheit and your pressure should be in PSI, and Z is your compressibility factor. So compressibility factor if given, then you have to consider it, and if not given, then you have to take the general Z. Now for the liquid capacity is basically what? Volume by its flow rate, then you can get the retention time. So from that equation, means time is equal to volume by flow rate. So this equation will give you a this basically equation in field unit. Here your volume is in BBL and flow rate is in BBL per day. You have liquid flow rate. Okay, now for designing the separator by the Sanjay Gupta, you have to take some consideration, fixed consideration into your mind. Length by diameter ratio should be between 3 to 8. So this is the first consideration, that length by diameter, any for any vertical or horizontal, your L by D should be between 3 to 8. Second consideration is for vertical separator, your liquid interference should be 2 feet above from the bottom and 4 feet below to the top bottom, below to the top. So your minimum vertical separator length should be 8 feet. So your for vertical separator, your length should be minimum of 6 feet. Same for horizontal separator, considering the liquid vapor interference, should be 10 inch above the bottom and 16 inch below the top. So your minimum diameter should be 26. So for taking your liquid vapor interference for horizontal, it should be your diameter constraint, and for vertical you have your length constraint. So diameter for horizontal separator should be minimum of 26 inch. Okay, now this is the Ken Androd method, where you have to mock these two equation. First equation is this, and second equation is this. This is how we derive these two equation. So here V is equal to Q by AG, where AG area for gas should be half of your separator area, so it's taken as a half. Now if you are converting your SCF per second into the mmscf per day, then you have this conversion. So you can get this conversion for the fields unit. Now terminal velocity. So terminal velocity, what is terminal velocity? It's basically Q by AG, means your flow rate by area for gas. So already Q is calculated here in field unit, and area is also calculated as half of area is available for the gas flow. Now this simplifies the equation into this. Now residence and residence time for gas is, it should be same. I already calculate that length, effective length by velocity, same your volume upon flow rate, same for residence time for gas, it's effective length upon the terminal velocity. So you have already get your you have already your VG. So put the equation, and this is TD is for the total, which is basically for the diameter, it's 24 by VT. VT is your flow rate, flow velocity. So by equating Tg and Td, which should be equal, you will get this equation. So mark this equation, and this is basically the derivation. Derivation will not come in basically get, but you have to mark this equation. And this is for the liquid capacity, which is also derived here. Look at that. Now from these two equation, like from this equation 1 and equation 2, you will get your diameter and effective length. Okay, same you will get from your Sanjay Gupta, and same from can enroll, both methods. Now seam to seam length. So what is seam to seam length? So basically this is our separator. Let's consider the horizontal separator. So this is our separator. Let me make it clear. This is our separator. Here we are not considering this is basically your seam to seam length, but effective length is not equal to seam to seam length, because there will be turbulence at inlet. There will be a turbulence at inlet, and there will be also turbulence at outlet or your vertex. So this is your effective length, where your separator separation process will occur. So this is your effective length, and this is your seam to seam length, LSSS. Okay, now same for vertical. So this equation come for the vertical, derivation is given down, or you can use the enroll book for deriving these two equation. This is for liquid capacity, and this is for gas capacity. From here you can calculate the diameter, and from here you can calculate the height of your vertical separator. And there is equation for seam to seam. You can use either of one of it for vertical, and same for horizontal. Now these are the units in which you have to put the all values. As I already discussed, in three phase separator there is oil bucket. So bucket and wear design. So this is your oil bucket, where basically your oil surface is almost here. It's almost same to your oil and oil emulsion height. So to obtain a basically desired oil pad height, water wear should be set distance below the oil wear. So this is your height of oil wear, and this is your height of water wear. So this difference is basically depends on which height you want to get for your oil pad. So now this is the basically equation, distance below oil wear. So this is delta H, is basically distance between your oil wear and your water wear, and this H is desired your oil pad height. So if you have a desired oil pad height, and you already get your density of your oil and water, then you can find the what should be the difference between your two wears, means your oil wear and your gas or water wear. So let's derive this equation. So using the Pascal law at both sides, so this is connected from the bottom basically. So let's apply the Pascal law at both sides. So rho oil multiplied to rho height of your oil pad plus rho w into hw is equal to rho w into hw dash. So this is basically height up to your water wear. So here applying Pascal law and equating with this, you will get this equation. Now simplifying it into the this formula, and putting your delta H by normal H naught plus HW minus HW dash. So let's understand how we get this equation. So this is basically your this will be almost same. Okay, so your HW means your oil pad height plus your HO plus HW minus this water wear height, you will get the delta H. So here we get this equation. Basically here we derived by the Pascal law this equation. Now let's again understand the designing of horizontal separator. So mark this equation. Derivation is already discussed. You have to remember these two equation. From these two equation you will have your effective length and your diameter, and From that you can calculate the seam to seam length and by using either of this equation. Now this is the basically table which will make which will basically for easy to understand how your separator design will go. So this is for two phase separator and this is for three phase separator. Vertical and horizontal both separator is taken into the consideration, and these are the equation basically for the seam to seam ratio and slender's ratio and seam to seam length. So you can take any of equation and calculate the seam to seam length. For all this designing, you have to take you may have to take consideration into the retention time. If retention time is not given in the exam, then you have to take the average retention time. So for if two phase separator is given, then your retention time should be 1 minute if your API gravity is greater than 35, and if 20 to 30 your retention time is 1.5, and from 10 to 20 then retention time will be 3 minutes. Same for three phase separation, you have to take consideration and you have to just remember the average for which we can use in exam for the exam purpose. Now these are the basically allowable entrant water along with gas outlet, which is basically allowable. So in both gallon and liter, the allowable water entrant is given here. Now instrumentation part of separator. Now I will discuss what type of instrumentation devices and where they are located and what are the function of that. So let's start with the inlet. So this is basically your inlet separator, your inlet liquid inlet to the separator. Now there is basically two access DV here, in which is known as your inlet valve. This may be a manual valve or shutdown valve. So this is your inlet. Then let's start from liquid outlet. So this is your level gauge LG. This is your level transmitter. Both are located in side to side. So this will basically, level gauge will indicate that what level your separator is there, and your level transmitter will give a signal to your your level troll or your LT controller, level transmitter and controller, which basically keep the level on a given set level value, which by opening and closing the level control valve. So here there is a level control valve which is basically operated by the level troll or level controller. I will discuss how this level controller will work. This is your this is your flow meter. So if this access DV will open, then there will be a flow. So flow meter will calculate the flow. So this flow meter may be your orifice meter or Coriolis meter or turbine meter. Any type of meter can be there, so which will basically give the flow. Now this is your drain. If you want to clean, then you will open this drain valve and you can drain the separator. Now there is a pressure gauge also there, at pressure and temperature gauge on the top. So this will indicate the pressure and temperature. Now there will be a pressure safety valve also there, where your if you set your separator at pressure safety value at as of 20 kg, when your separator pressure will reach to 20 kg, this pressure safety valve will open and which causing the reduction in your pressure. Also I will discuss that this level, there are basically two valves which is very important. One is LCV and second one is PCV, pressure control valve and your level control valve. Okay, so these both have a different function. Your PCV is basically failed to open, so when there is no air supply or any emergency occur, at that time it is failed to open. When there is no supply or no signal, then it will remain in an open position. And your level control valve LCV is basically failed to close. So if there is no signal or any emergency occurs, your level control valve LCV will remain closed. So there will be a no flow outside. Now there is a pressure transmitter also. which basically transmit pressure transmitter will get will take a pneumatic pressure and will transfer into the electronic signal or pneumatic signal and give to the pressure controller. I will discuss how this controller will work. So this is basically instrumentation part of your separator. Now this controller are having a three different properties or three functions. One is proportional, second one is integral, and third one is differential. So proportional is very basic one. PI means your proportional and integral, which is advanced one, and very advanced one is proportional, integral, and differential. So in differential you have time delay as additional function. Reset is basically additional function of your integral. And if you have proportional, then only you have a proportional band or gain. So for proportional, this is the basically your action and this is your pressure. So in proportional one, your action is depend on your pressure rise. And for your PI, it's basically also depend on a reset. And for PID, it's also having a time delay. Now I already discussed your LCV and PCVs. So PCVs are basically used in your gas outlet, and LCVs are used in your liquid outlet. These are the basically failed to close, and these are the basically failed to open. These all are basically global only. Now controller. So controller having basically six major components. Starting with the proportional bellows. So if you are having a proportional controller, then you have a proportional bellow, vent bellow, reverse block. Then this is the basically Bowden tube. I will discuss how this work. Basically this is not so much important, but this is how your controller is look. So just remember. So this is basically a Bowden tube. There is a constant supply of air, means of pneumatic supply. This is your basically set point value. Here you can set like 20 kg, 30 kg, 60% level. You can control the parameters from here. Then this bellow will basically give a signal to the your LCV or PCV, and by that signal it will operate. Now this how instrumentation or your pneumatic signal will change into the electronic signal by the IP transducers. So basically, first of all, your pressure regulator or pressure control will give a signal to the pneumatic transducer. This transducer will give to the your human HMI interference, means human machine interference signal, or your level transmitter will also give the signal to the your pneumatic transducer. Then this pneumatic transducer will give the signal into the pneumatic to the pneumatic controller, and by the pneumatic signal it will operate the control valves. I already discussed. So basically two type of pneumatic controller are there for the level first one is basically with the pneumatic supply. So there is basically displacer is there, which is floating in the LT, means this is level transmitter vessel, or there is a vessel type there. I already discussed which is connected with the separator. So a change in liquid level buoys up the displacer, and corresponding a vertical moment, the displacer results in an angular moment. Angular moment of displacement rod around the knife edge bearing. So here there is a knife edge bearing is present, which will cause the annular change, and annular moment will give a torque to the torque tube assembly, where basically torsional spring is there, and which will give a basically pneumatic signal to your PCVs and LCVs, your controllers. So this is how your pneumatic level controller will work. Now digital controller, so same, there is a display size there, your knife edge bearing is there. Basically here change in angular position will cause a change in magnetic field, and this magnetic field will give a electronic signal to your level transmitter or level controller. So this is how your digital level transmitter will work. Now PCBs. So PCBs are basically operated on a set pre-decide value. So safety valve is a mechanism for automatic release of gas from a pressurized vessel or the system when your pressure or temperature will exceed the preset value. So you already preset the value like 50 kg. So when your separator pressure is greater than 50, then this your PSV will pop up and it will release the gas. So these are the basically all instrumentation. Thank you friends. ये वीडियो को लाइक करिए, शेयर करिए और हमारे पेट्रोज्ञान YouTube चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करिए. और फॉर मोर अपडेट्स फॉलो अस ऑन YouTube एंड Facebook एंड Instagram. थैंक यू.